In case you haven't heard of serverless, the idea is that you write some code, upload it to a platform like AWS Lambda, and it'll run whenever you want and however many times you want without you ever having to manage servers. Lambda has managed to magically scale this, and in this video, you'll learn how. This means you don't need to update the operating system, install certificates, or any other maintenance you would have to do for your own computer. AWS takes care of it all for you. Importantly, there are some limitations to Lambda, like your function can have a maximum of 10 gigabytes of RAM and run for at most 15 minutes. Even then, it's incredibly powerful and at the core of so many distributed systems. So, how does it work? What actually goes on behind the scenes when you call a Lambda function? Before getting into how the Lambda workers behave, let's cover how a request is routed to a server, which, yes, there are actually servers that run your code behind the scenes. For now, think of a request as being mapped one-to-one with a server, so one request will get complete ownership of a bare metal EC2 instance in some server farm that AWS owns for 15 minutes. We'll update this model as the video progresses. When you invoke a Lambda function, Lambda has a set of load balancers which send the request to a service called the Frontend Invoke Service. This frontend isn't the UI of the platform, but rather the routing layer that gets hit first within AWS. The frontend invoke service authenticates and authorizes your request and gets function metadata from the counting service. Once it has that information, it asks the assignment service for a worker to send the invocation payload to. Once it has the worker, which again we'll say is the entire server, the invoke service can send the payload to that server, which will download the code and language runtime, execute it, and process the response. If the assignment service doesn't have an idle worker, it will ask the placement service to optimally find space to create a new one. So, in summary, your request hits a load balancer and gets routed to the frontend invoke service, which gets metadata from the counting service. Then, it gets a worker from the assignment service, which might need to ask the placement service to allocate a new one. Then, once a worker is ready, the invoke service can send the payload to the worker, and once the worker is done, it becomes idle and can expire. There is also a control plane service which manages the assignment service, but I'm not going to cover it in this video. Okay, now let's dive deeper into the architecture of a worker. In the current approach, when a Lambda function gets invoked, we take the request and assign it to an existing server. One request gets one server. You can probably come up with a few problems with this approach, namely the fact that if AWS has 100,000 servers dedicated to Lambda, then they'd only be able to serve 100,000 requests every 15 minutes. For reference, the traffic that Lambda gets is estimated to be in the millions of invocations per second. With that being said, there is a lot we can learn from this approach. For starters, the security and isolation here is fantastic. There's no possibility of someone else's code accessing or impacting your function execution because they're running on different computers. As far as your code being isolated goes, it's hard to get better than this approach. So the challenge we face is how can we be multi-tenant, meaning we run multiple of these functions on one server, without compromising the security and isolation benefits? Think of it like having a home in the middle of nowhere. If you live there, you don't have to deal with noisy neighbors and the possibility of a break-in is very low. But we want those same guarantees while having multiple families live in a single apartment complex. Conceptually, it's important to realize the magnitude of this problem. The smallest Lambda function you can allocate has 128 megabytes of RAM, and the biggest has 10 gigabytes. If we take an AWS server that has hundreds of gigabytes of RAM, we want a way to fit these invocations into that server. The goal for overhead in Lambda is 10%, so if your function has a requirement of 1 GB of RAM, then the solution should be lightweight enough such that the overhead should be about 100 megabytes. Visually, your functions are these individual circles, and the work that Lambda needs to do should fit in the empty space. If you're familiar with container technologies like Docker, you might be thinking it's a perfect fit for this problem. They seem isolated, can run your code, and can be started and stopped very easily. While all of this is true, the structure for Linux containers looks something like this. Notice how everyone is running code on the same operating system kernel. The primary security here is using features like namespaces and seccomp, which limit which system calls you're trying to invoke. There's effectively one layer of isolation here, which wasn't good enough for Lambda, since security is the number one concern. So instead, Lambda opted for a different approach, virtualization. Lambda looked into existing technologies like unikernels, but they didn't meet the requirements since we want to run unmodified code targeting Linux. For that, there are existing virtualization solutions like Xen, which is a hypervisor. The role of a hypervisor is to sit on top of hardware and abstract its resources like CPU, memory, and storage so that multiple virtual machines can run concurrently in isolation. In case you're wondering, AWS EC2 instances have their own hypervisors called Nitro and are shared by multiple accounts. If you want your own servers without hypervisors like Lambda does, you can use bare metal EC2 instances. Alternatively, you can use a kernel-based virtual machine like KVM, which is a Linux kernel module that turns the host into a hypervisor. Once you have KVM in place, tools like QEMU can be used to manage and run these virtual machines. Xen and QEMU are great, but they're a bit heavy for what Lambda needs. Because Lambda controls the hardware they run on, they don't need the code for all legacy devices and any other bloat the software has picked up over the past decade. After exhausting all existing options, it was time for AWS to create their own solution. The main bloat in the KVM plus QEMU approach comes from the fact that QEMU has almost 2 million lines of code since they need to support everything. So what if Lambda just rewrites it but only keeps the parts that they need so that speed dramatically improves? Well, that's exactly what Firecracker is. Firecracker is a virtual machine monitor that is as minimal as possible to support Lambda. It has no BIOS support or legacy device support. Firecracker works with KVM to create micro virtual machines, or micro VMs, which are stripped down to only include the stuff that is absolutely necessary for the Lambda use case. They also wrote it in Rust instead of C to further decrease the attack surface area. So let's go back to the front end. Whenever the placement service assigns a new worker, it's actually creating a slot inside of a server. Let's zoom into one slot. Inside the slot, a Firecracker process is started. The Firecracker process is responsible for communicating with KVM to set up a micro VM. The untrusted code is the customer's uploaded code, and the guest kernel is the kernel of the micro VM. Just like before, the host kernel is the actual EC2 metal instance. The customer code executes on a micro VM's virtual CPU, which KVM provides. Firecracker also has additional logic for emulating devices for I/O. With this approach, there are several layers of protection on top of what the container approach provided, including the fact that your code is running on its own copy of the Linux kernel in a virtual machine. Once the slot is done executing your code, it'll stay alive until the lease has expired. The slots switch between busy, idle, and expired. When the lease expires and a new slot has to be initialized, Firecracker goes through the process of setting up a micro VM again, which is what a cold start is. Otherwise, your function gets a warm start, meaning there's already a worker slot ready to execute your code. These cold starts happen so infrequently because Lambda has these workers ready to go most of the time, so when writing a Lambda function, it's really more important that you're writing in an efficient way, such as not importing the entire AWS SDK. With that being said, there are many optimizations Lambda has done, such as reducing the JVM startup time through snap start, always leaving some slots warm through provision concurrency, and allowing you to configure your maximum concurrency. Thanks for watching.